Dear friend, today I am going to talk about the diabetes mellitus, which is one of the most common disease in whole of the world. What is its burden and the management? You must have seen the newspaper in your country, or you can see here also the cuttings, how the burden of the disease has increased, and in the media also it's getting lots of attention because of its increased prevalence and is causing loss of morbidity and mortality. So when you can see the figure of 2007 and when the predicted figure of 2025, you can see there is an increase in the prevalence of diabetes and even in the impaired glucose tolerance, that is the pre-diabetic stage, it's increasing, and the number of people are suffering from it also is increasing tremendously. Here you can see global figure and the figure of the US, there is more than 100 times increment will be there by 2030, and this is a projection by WHO. You can see the prevalence of diabetes has increasing almost every corner of the world, but it is more commonly in the developing country like India and even in the developed country, but it is more common in developing country. You can see the figure of 2000 and how the prevalence is going to increase by 2030. This figure is given by the WHO. And when you see the graph, the increase is that is the more worrying. Increase is the more in the age group of 45 to 64. That is the more in the productive age group. In developed country, the increment is around 26%. In older age group, it is 176%. But when you see in the developing country, in the reproductive age group, when the people are working and they are doing the work, the prevalence has increased by 247%, and in the older age group it is increased by almost 300%. So the magnitude of diabetes is going to more in the developing country, and this is a figure worldwide. So there is an alarming rise of diabetes in both younger age group and age group of the reproductive age and the older age group. So what are the various risk factors for the diabetes? It is seen and it is proven by the study, the any family history of diabetes, and that some ethnic population are more prone for the diabetes. Is there any history of heart disease and any woman delivering baby more than 9 pounds or diabetes during pregnancy, and some there are modifiable risk factor like overweight, high blood pressure and physical inactivity. So here you can see there is a dual epidemics of obesity and diabetes, like they are going hand in hand. So and country like our in India, the prevalence is rising very fast. Like you can see in the 1972, the prevalence of diabetes was 2.1%. By 2002 it was 12.7%, and today in 2012 the prevalence is around 18 to 20%. So there is a 10 time increase in diabetes last 40 years. So as per WHO, it is taken as a metabolic disorder of multiple etiology of characterized by chronic hyperglycemia with disturbances of carbohydrate, fat and protein metabolism resulting from defect in insulin secretion, insulin action or both. And just be little bit regarding the physiology, how the food become the glucose. During the digestion, food is broken down to the sugar, that is the glucose. Insulin, a hormone made by the pancreas, lowers the blood sugar by helping the sugar move from the blood into the cell, and the body cells use sugar for energy. So there are the diagnostic criteria for diabetes. As per the ADA guideline, it can be diagnosed either by the glycosylated hemoglobin or the blood sugar. If the HbA1c, that is the glycosylated hemoglobin, is more than or equal to 6.5%, it's taken as a diabetes. But it should be done in certified lab by NGSP or DCCT SA standardization. And if the fasting glucose is more than 126 mg%, and postprandial glucose more than 200 milligram percent, or any random sugar more than 200 and with the classic symptom of hyperglycemia or hyperglycemic crisis, then you can diagnose that person has a diabetes mellitus. There is another category, like people, they are risk increases for the diabetes, or you can say, you can call them as a pre-diabetic stage. If there is fasting is 100 to 125, then it's called impaired fasting glucose. 2 hour post glucose is 140 to 190, is called impaired glucose tolerance. And HbA1c between 5.5 to 6.4%. This is a classification of diabetes: type 1 diabetes, type 2 diabetes, other specific type of diabetes, like which can cause by some other reason, like chronic or recurrent pancreatitis, Moody, drug induced, and other autoimmune diseases, and other entities, gestational diabetes. What is type 1 diabetes? It was initially formerly known as IDDM, that is insulin dependent diabetes. It is caused by the autoimmune, and it is mostly common under the age of 40, and is usually present with the positive ketone and weight loss. Patients are usually lean, and marker of autoimmunity are present: islet cell autoantibody, family history are positive in 10% of the cases, 30 to 50% concordance is found in identical twins. And type 2 diabetes, it is initially or formerly known as a non-insulin dependent diabetes. It is a disorder of both insulin action and the insulin secretion, and it is patients are usually obese, usually over 50 years, but it is not true always, mainly in the developing country like India, you know, the most of the patients are less than 50 years, and the marker of autoimmunity are negative, and family history of diabetes positive in 30% of the cases, and there is a nearly 100% concordance in identical twins. And type 2 diabetes, approximately 90% of the all diabetic cases it's account for worldwide, and they may have symptoms. This is the most common, and patient may have they have usually loss of 50% of beta cell function at the diagnosis, and further 25% will lost within 6 months of the diagnosis. So just briefly, what is the difference between type 1 and type 2? Type 1 diabetes, they cannot make any insulin, they have absolute deficiency of the insulin. In type 2, they can make, but they cannot make some insulin, but cannot properly use the insulin. So they have a like secretory defect, and also the insulin resistance, and other variety of diabetes is maturity onset diabetes in young, and it's more commonly called as Moody, M-O-D-Y, and it is uncommon. It is approximately 2% of all the diabetes, and patient are relatively insulinopenia. It's occur before 25 year of the age, and mutation in gene encoding for the beta cell has been found, and there are 6 different genes are identified, and they label as Moody 1, 2 and so on. So what are the difference between type 2 and the Moody? The age of onset, type 2 is usually middle to old, Moody is young and child. Pathophysiology, as I told you, type 2 has a beta cell dysfunction plus insulin resistance. Moody has only beta cell dysfunction. Is there any role of environment? Yeah, type 2 has a considerable role, but Moody minimal. Obesity, the type 2 has a frequent obesity, frequently. In Moody, obesity is rare. Inheritance, type 2 has a polygenic or heterogenic, but Moody has autosomal dominant. Usually they have a family history of inheritance. Here you can see how the affected father had transmitted to his 50% of the children. So for like when you monitor the diabetes, or when you want to diagnose the diabetes, both HbA1c, that is a glycosylated hemoglobin, and blood sugar, both are important, and both should be done initially, and subsequently HbA1c should be done twice a year, and blood sugar monitoring, if it is type 2, then once like 2 weeks to 4 weekly, and if it is type 1, then probably 2 to 3 times per week we have to check the different sugar. Now we have seen like what is the burden of diabetes, what are the different type of the diabetes, and now we move to the management of diabetes and pre-diabetic state. So first we discuss the management of pre-diabetes, that is impaired fasting glucose and impaired glucose tolerance. So this is very important because you can prevent this patient further progressing into the diabetic state. So intervention for the pre-diabetic should be like weight loss 5 to 10%, increase physical activity, moderate physical exercise 150 minutes per week, add metformin if HbA1c is more than 6%, they are hypertensive, they have a low HDL cholesterol, they have high triglyceride, they are obese, and they are less than 60 years of age, and the family history of diabetes in the first degree relatives. And you have to monitor blood sugar every 3 monthly, and you have to tell the what should be your target, like IGT and AFG target should be 90 to 110, and postprandial should be 140 to 160, and they should see their doctor every 6 months to 1 yearly. So type 2 diabetes management, the standard of medical care should be symptomatic improvement in the osmotic symptoms, weight loss, infection, and so on. Decrease the risk of acute metabolic decompensation like diabetic ketoacidosis or hyperosmolar non-ketotic coma. Reduce the risk of development, progression of micro or macrovascular complication, and make them less atherogenic. What should be the target for the control? The target for control should be like glycemia, hypertension, lipids, screening, prevention and treatment of the complication, and most important, behavior modification. The criteria for our glycemic control should be HbA1 should be between 6.5 to 7%, pre-meal blood sugar 70 to 120 for young, and if the patient is little bit older you can keep 90 or 100 to 120, and post-meal should be less than 160, and postprandial exertion should less than 40 mg%, that is from fasting to post meal it should be less than increase of less than 40 mg%. 50% of SMBG values should be within the target range. SMBG is self monitoring of the blood glucose. So when you see the HbA1c, then how you interpret it? There is a rough formula to calculate into the average blood sugar. HbA1c of 6, it denotes 126 mg% of the average blood sugar. HbA1c of 7, it denotes around 154 mg% of the blood sugar, and so on. Like HbA1c of 11 is 269. So approximately, usually you should multiply by like 28 to 29. When you see the report card, like most of the patient in US report of diabetes, one study was done, how they summarize the report card of diabetes in the US. Like 43% of the subject have HbA1c less than 7%, 18% has HbA1c more than 9.5%, so more than 50% are poorly controlled. Out of this, around 18% are very poorly controlled. 60% has a BP of less than 140/90. 30% have BP of less than 130/80. 11% has LDL cholesterol less than 100 mg%. That is, around 90% has LDL cholesterol more than 100. So first line of management in type 2 diabetes is the dietary management. You have to utilize the medical nutrition therapy. It should consist of weight reduction, calorie intake should reduce gradually by 500 kilocalorie per day. Dietary fat should be less than 30%, saturated fat less than 7%, and reduce the trans fat. So what should a diet of type 2 diabetes or even type 1 diabetes contain? Carbohydrates should be 55 to 60%, protein should be 10 to 20%, fat, as I told you in the previous slide, less than 30%, saturated fat less than 10%, PUFA and less than 10%, and MUFA 10 to 15%, fiber 25 gram per 1000 calorie, salt should be 3 gram per day, and they should can use sweetener and the alcohol. The sugar alcohol and non-alcoholic sweetener are safe. Restrict alcohol 1 to 2 drinks per day only. Routine antioxidant like vitamin C, E, carotene, chromium, it is not recommended. What exercise this type 2 or type 1 diabetic patient should do? They should have a 150 minutes of moderate activity per week, and they should be managed with the management of the obesity, either by simple exercise and diet modification, or if indicated, then anti-obesity drugs should be used, or even if there are morbid obesity, the bariatric surgery can be advised. What are the option for the drug management in type 2 diabetes? See, here we are mainly discussing the type 2 because type 1 people are required only insulin, and the population of type 2 is more, so we are more concentrating up to management of the type 2 diabetes. So the mainstay of the patient who failed to the diet and therapy are the oral hypoglycemic agent. It is in the type 2 diabetes. As we know, there are three main defects in type 2 diabetes: insulin resistance, impaired insulin secretions, or increased hepatic glucose production. And there are five major class of OHAs. First and most commonly used are sulfonylurea. Second, biguanides. You can say sometimes biguanides are more used than sulfonylurea. In thiazolidinediones, alpha glucosidase inhibitor, DPP-4 inhibitor, and exenatide. So let's discuss about the sulfonylurea. Should OHA be started? Is the patient likely to respond to OHA? Likely to respond to sulfonylurea if the onset of diabetes is more than 30 years, they have a residual beta cell function, duration of diabetes is less than 5 years, normal weight, or moderately obese, demonstrated compliance with the drug and the exercise. If after these two things they are uncontrolled, then only you can add diet and the exercise, and the fasting glucose is less than 300 mg, and if it is coming more than 350 or more, something like this reading, then you should always start with the insulin. There are various sulfonylureas are available, in our country, glipizides, glibenclamide, glimepirides. They can be given in divided doses and single doses depending upon which sulfonylurea you are using. Sometimes patient asks which one is the better. There is little or no evidence that one sulfonylurea is therapeutically more effective than other. A rapid acting sulfonylurea may improve acute insulin release and promote better control of postprandial blood glucose. Long acting sulfonylurea may be given better control of overnight blood glucose. Is the glimepiride better than other sulfonylurea? Presume advantage. Is there any reality? They have some extra hepatic effects, but this is the little clinical significance. Low binding to sulfonylurea 2A or 2B receptor and does not block the ischemic precondition in the heart. Interestingly, but more studies are required. Stimulate the first phase insulin, but it has a questionable clinical significance. Other most commonly used drug are the insulin sensitizer, biguanides, is the most commonly known as a metformin, thiazolidinediones, that is the glitazones, either pioglitazone or rosiglitazone. The metformin, we know, it acts by enhancing the sensitivity of both hepatic and peripheral tissues, primarily muscles, to the insulin, suppression of the hepatic glucose output, inhibitory effect on the hepatic glycogenolysis, impair absorption of glucose from gut, no direct effect on the beta cell, and no hypoglycemia. And efficacy is concerned, it decreases the fasting blood plasma glucose level by 60 to 70 mg per cent and HbA1c value by 1.5 to 2 percent. Decrease the increment in the plasma glucose after the meals. Efficacy effect increase proportionally in dose range of 500 mg to 2 grams per day. Induce the weight loss. Does not increase or even reduce the plasma insulin level. Improve the plasma lipid profile. What type of therapy we can give with the metformin? Either it can be in monotherapy or in combination. After failure of dietary therapy in type 2, especially in overweight patient, after failure to achieve the acceptable glycemic control with sulfonylurea, thiazolidinediol therapy. What will be the dose schedule? Start the metformin dose 500 mg twice, given with the two largest meal to minimize the gastrointestinal side effect. Fasting plasma glucose level become to decrease within 3 to 5 days of the therapy is started and reach nadir within 1 to 2 weeks. The dose should be increased by 500 mg per day every 2 weeks until the desired therapeutic goal is achieved or maximum dose of 2.5 gram is reached. A long-acting preparation is also available. It can be taken once a day. Fewer gastrointestinal side effect than does the generic metformin. 80% to 85% of the maximum glucose lowering effect is observed with daily dose of 1.5 grams of the metformin. What are the side effects of the metformin? They have a gastrointestinal symptoms like diarrhea, nausea, abdominal discomfort, and so on. Risk of lactic acidosis in patient with any of the listed contraindication like any infection, kidney disease, and so on. Hypoglycemia taken with the sulfonylurea or presence of alcohol abuse. Contraindication, absolute contraindication are the renal, creatinine more than 1.5 in male, 1.4 in the female, or creatinine clearance less than 50 ml per minute. Any hepatic disease, cardiac or respiratory insufficiency. Any hypoxic condition, severe infection, trauma or shock. Alcohol abuse, history of lactic acidity, use of intravenous radiographic contrast agent, and in pregnancy it is contraindicated. What are the relative contraindication? Age more than 60 year, vitamin B12 deficiency. What precaution you should take? Medical history should be checked for any contraindication. Hemoglobin and plasma creatinine concentration should be checked periodically. Cessation of metformin treatment should be indicated if the patient develops life-threatening medical problem, and discontinue 48 hours prior to the surgery. The next group of drug is thiazolidinediones, that is the glitazones, are class of insulin sensitizing agent introduced in the clinical practice in way back 1997. And initially the three agents were available: troglitazone, rosiglitazone, pioglitazones. What are the mechanism of action? It promotes the adipocyte differentiation and shift of the adipocyte from the metabolically active visceral depot to less active subcutaneous adipose tissue. Direct stimulation of insulin mediated glucose uptake and disposal in the skeletal muscle. Enhance the insulin action and decrease the glucose and free fatty acid level. And the hypoglycemic effects. Placebo control study has suggested both the moderately effective in achieving the glycemic control. At maximum doses, these two drugs seem to be decreased glycosylated hemoglobin value on average by 1 to 1.5%. Which are patient to be given? Rosiglitazone and pioglitazone are currently approved in most countries for the treatment of hyperglycemia in patients with type 2 diabetes, either as mono or in combination with sulfonylurea or the metformin. When you use in the monotherapy, pioglitazone and rosiglitazone have a similar efficacy. In a randomized placebo controlled trial of patients with pioglitazone or rosiglitazone resulted in significant reduction in the fasting glucose concentration, that is up to 30 to 60 mg per dl, and 1 to 1.5% in glycosylated hemoglobin A1C value compared with the placebo. Decrease in fasting glucose observed as early in the second week of the therapy. Thiazolidinediones have been studied in combination with sulfonylurea, insulin, and metformin. Reduction in hemoglobin HbA1c level increased with the combination therapy. The combination of glitazone metformin more effective in obese patient. Improvement in insulin resistance and beta cell function were also greatest in obese patient. What should be the dose? Starting dose of rosiglitazone 4 mg per day, either single or in two divided doses, inadequate after 8 weeks of therapy, dose may be increased to 8 mg per day. And starting dose of pioglitazone is 50 mg per day in single dose. If response is inadequate after 8 weeks of therapy, dose may be increased to 45 mg per day. If no response to monotherapy, combination with other anti-diabetic agent can be added. The safety and efficacy in adolescent and children has not been established. Adverse effect, hepatic injury have been reported. The frequency and risk remain uncertain. If the patient exhibit clinical or laboratory evidence of active liver disease, like increase in SGPT more than 2.5 times, 3 times, then this drug should not be given. No substantial evidence that the newer agent associated with nephrotoxicity. It associated with weight gain after 6 months and dose dependent. Highest incidence of edema has been reported with glitazones are used in combination with insulin or in patient with pre-existing edema should be used with caution. Fluid retention may be severe enough to exacerbate or precipitate the heart failure should be used in caution in patient with mild degree of the heart failure. Slight decrease in hemoglobin and hematocrit probably without any clinical response. Mild to moderate hypoglycemia reported in combination with sulfonuria and insulin. So what are the contraindication? Patient with liver disease and above congestive heart, like advanced congestive heart failure, severe renal insufficiency, on dialysis, pregnancy, breastfeeding woman, what precaution we should take? Premenopausal, anovulatory female with insulin resistance, female receiving OC therapy. What about the monitoring? It is recommended that SGPT level be measured every 2 months during the first year of the glitazone therapy and periodically thereafter. If at any time SGPT level increases to more than 3 times the upper limit of the patient, the drug should be stopped. On therapy recheck, if remain high, the glitazone should be discontinued. If patient develops symptoms of congestive heart failure, discontinue the drug. If edema not responding to diuretics, discontinue the drug. So we have to very carefully starting in the patient who has the slightest doubt of like any heart disease. What are the other non-sulfonuria secretagogues? These include repaglinide and nitaglinide. They act by increasing the release of insulin from functioning beta cell. They bind to different receptor on the beta cell and they have a very short duration of action. This quick on and off effect decrease the incidence of hypoglycemia and are most useful in isolated postprandial hypoglycemia. Side effect, they can cause hypoglycemia like any other sulfonuria, although the incidence is less than that with the sulfonuria. Other group is alpha glucosidase inhibitor. The agents available are carboz and miglitol. Mechanism of action, they decrease the rate of ingested carbohydrate absorption in the small intestine. They act by competitive reversible inhibitor of alpha glucosidase and alpha amylase, which are involved in the conversion of non-absorbable complex sugar into the absorbable glucose. The main glucosidase enzyme inhibited include glucosamine, sucrose, maltase and isomaltase. Lactase is not inhibited, so lactose intolerance is not seen. Side effect and the contraindication, the most common is gastrointestinal side effect like abdominal discomfort, diarrhea, flatulence are seen in user. These agents are contraindication in patient with inflammatory bowel disease, intestinal obstruction or predisposition to obstruction, cirrhosis and the renal failure. An important thing to remember is that hypoglycemia occurring in the patient due to combination therapy of which one of these glucose inhibitors should be managed with glucose rather than the complex sugar as their conversion to glucose is inhibited. Other newer drugs are the GLP-1 agonist and DPP-4 inhibitors. And the lastly, if these OHS are not responding, then patient should be given the option of insulin or insulin human or insulin analogs are available. The newer class of anti-diabetes are the like they based on the incretin based therapy. And they are DPP-4 inhibitors and exenatide. How this GLP-1 agonist act, they reduce the blood sugar, they slow down, have a quickly food and stomach and make patient full, help the patient make more insulin when the blood sugar is high, they keep the liver from releasing too much sugar into the blood. Now lastly, like the other mode of like therapy, when the OHS is not responsible in the for the patient of type 1, for them the insulin is the life saving therapy. The so who patient who need the insulin, the type 1 patient whose body is not producing any insulin, type 2 who do not always produce enough insulin, and it is given as a subcutaneous injection. All insulins are made by using the genetic engineering, like traditionals are the regular and the NPH, and analogs has been made from these. They are called rapid acting or the longer acting. There are also premixed formulation that contain rapid acting and intermediate acting insulin together. And this is how the insulin act. You give the basal, it remain in the body for the longer time and provide the basal insulin. And before each meal, you give the short acting, and you have a peak of these insulin. Here you can see the peak. So what are the type of the insulin? They are regular insulin, NPH insulin, and various insulin analogs are there, premix insulin are there, or short peptide mimics like things are there. Regulars, the various insulins are in the market, like insulin, human insulin R, NPH, Lente, Ultra Lente, and so on. And analogs are like Lispro, Aspartate, and the long acting, these are the short acting, and the long acting is Glargine, Determine, Glulisine. So this is the table which you see the like what are the different type of insulin, what is their onset. Like the short acting insulin, their onset of action is very fast, start with like immediately, like 10 minutes to half an hour, and it lasts for one peak is last for around 5 hours. And in intermediate, the action of onset start 1 to 1.5 hour, and the peak for 6 to 12 hours, and the duration is around 12 to 16 hours. Long acting, the duration is 24 hours. Other important aspect is like cardiovascular disease and the diabetes. As we know that the in patient with the diabetes, the CVD, the primary cause of death among is 55% of patient with the diabetic, and ISD responsible of 40% of the death, and the risk of mortality is 2 to 4 times that of the person without diabetes. Over 10 years, the number of hospitalization. Okay, then probability of death from the coronary heart disease in the patient with type 2 with and without. Here you can say that the type 2 diabetes is equivalent, like mortality is equivalent to the patient who are having the MI but they are without diabetes. So that's why it is called the cardiac equivalent disease. And in the South Asia, the problem is very high. There is a 3 to 5 fold increase in the risk for MI and cardiovascular death, and it's occur in the younger age, and the anterior location of the MI is the most common, and most likely they have a significant left main and multivessel disease and distal coronary artery disease. So what are different dyslipidemia occurs in the type 2 diabetes? They have increased TG, increased LDL cholesterol, increased postprandial lipemia, increased remnant, increased small dose LDL particle, and decreased LDL cholesterol. And the important key factor is the insulin resistance. And the category of risk based on the lipoprotein level in adult with the diabetes, suppose the LDL is more than 130, they are categorized as the high risk, and the less than 100, they are categorized as low risk. There are various hypolipidemic agents are available for diabetic dyslipidemia, like primary strategies, lower the LDL cholesterol, secondary strategy should be raise HDL cholesterol and lower the triglyceride. Other approaches are non-HDL cholesterol, ApoB and remnant. The various hypolipidemic drugs available are statin, fibrase, nicotinic acids derivative. Others are like omega-3 fatty acids and so on. Other important aspect of treating diabetes is to give them antiplatelet therapy, and usually the aspirin is given in the dose of 75 to 162 milligram per day. It is essential for the primary prevention, and the primary prevention should be considered in all the male less than 50 years, female less than 60 years, and with any of the following risk factor like family history of coronary artery disease, hypertension, dyslipidemia, smoking, microalbuminuria. And in the secondary prevention, the aspirin should be added with the clopidogrel. And patients should stop smoking. There should be counsel for the regarding the diabetes, they're important of the control, important the control of the lipids, hypertension, and the important of the drug intervention. Screening. This is a very important aspect. For the CAD, screen all the patient for the risk for CAD for 10 years, treat the risk factor. If they have established CAD, then give the ACE inhibitor, aspirin, statin and clopidogrel. Beta blocker for at least 2 years, avoid glitazones in symptomatic heart failure. Metformin should be given only in the stable cardiac failure, but not in a stable patient with the or congestive cardiac failure. Nephropathy, for them screening should be done with the annual using urine microalbumin, and creatinine should be assessed. If they have a microalbuminuria, start with ACE inhibitor or ARBs. Control the hypertension, target should be 125 to 125 systolic and 75 diastolic. You should rule out any obstructive uropathy or UTI. Statin is very controversial, but since they have a high risk of cardiovascular disease, they should be given the statin, and protein intake should be restricted to 0.8 gram per kg per day. There should be have an annual fundus examination for retinopathy. It should be done by the experienced ophthalmologist. They should look for any macular edema, severe NPDR and PDR. And neuropathy, it should like clinical examination for distal symmetry neuropathy, and patient should be given education if for the any symptomatic neuropathy. Just few slides regarding the gestational diabetes. It is occurring in the pregnant female at the gestation of 24 to 28 weeks. May go away after the baby is born, but some women with this type of diabetes may be more likely to develop permanent diabetes after the pregnancy. It can cause problem for the baby, including heart and the lung problem and problem with the baby's sugar. And which are the patient high risk for the gestational pregnancy? Obese women with the family members with the diabetes, and more common in African American, Hispanic, Latin Americans, Native Americans, and even in the Asians. So till now we have seen like what is the burden of the diabetes, how to diagnose the diabetes, what are the different type of the diabetes, how to treat these diabetes. But there are some good news. We can prevent these diabetes also. So what are these methods we can adopt? How can I prevent diabetes in myself and my children? If somebody is, your patient is asking, then you can tell them you should walk for 30 minutes per day or 3 times a week. Try walking more than taking the bus or subway. Take the stair instead of the elevator. Try buying an exercise video to use at home. Find a friend to exercise with you. You should eat healthy. Eat a diet low in fat, low in carbohydrate and high in fiber. Limit the fast food. Limit the soda and the juices. Parent examples help children from good habits. Lose the weight. Obesity is a major risk factor for developing diabetes. Exercise and healthy eating can help you maintain a healthy weight and lower your risk for developing diabetes. decrease the screen time. Instead of watching the TV or playing the video games with your kids, go for a walk or go to the park together. Cut down your TV time from 4 hours a day to 2 hours a day and can decrease the children's risk of being overweight or developing pre-diabetes. So, and see your doctor for regular checkup. Follow the advice on how to lower the blood pressure and cholesterol. Having a diabetes along with obesity, high blood pressure and high cholesterol increase your risk for heart disease and kidney. So limit the alcohol. Ask your doctor for information how to stop the smoking, and you should dial your helpline for any other program. Thanking you.